please just let me know either during the Q&A or if there's something that I miss or you didn't understand, please feel free to send a chat and we'll be able to pick it up right away. I have to remember how to use all the tools now. So what I want to do is look quickly at a few issues. Where do the negotiations stand from sort of two different perspectives, do less harm or do no harm? And by that I mean in terms of addressing the concerns that have come up as a result of the multiple arbitrations under other international investment treaties, NAFTA's Chapter 11 plus an array of international treaties that spans the globe, including approximately 1,200 that involve European countries that will otherwise be covered by CETA. So there's that first issue of do no harm. Have they managed to find language that reduces the potential impacts of the investor protection provisions on the ability of governments to regulate effectively? Then there's a second issue I'll address. How do we do good using these types of investment treaties? Can we harness investment and therefore investment treaties to do good from a broader sustainable development perspective? I'll look briefly at some of the dispute settlement issues and draw some conclusions. And I've noted at the bottom that the text packet passages that I'm using come from the April 4th document, and in one particular case, the passage from the investor state, that document is actually dated April 3rd. So that's what I'm working from, and those are the kinds of issues I'll try and address. In terms of do less harm, I'll try and go quickly, but hopefully in plain language, or at least give the implications in plain language, through a number of the provisions, the fair and equitable treatment provision, the umbrella clause that continues to remain in the text, though in square brackets, so it's not agreed yet, the provision on expropriation, the most favored nation provision, which is at this point perhaps the most troubling of the remaining outstanding issues, the exceptions to national treatment and Article 20 of the GATT type exceptions, I'll look at quickly in some market access issues. Fair and equitable treatment, or FET. The question is often asked, why is that so important? It doesn't seem to be from a plain language perspective, a general perspective, troubling to guarantee to an investor that you're going to treat them fairly and equitably. The problem is that fair and equitable treatment as a legal term has very broad legal elements to it. And identifying what those are has become increasingly difficult because of a series of conflicting decisions as to the scope of what they mean. So given that there's a variety of conflicting decisions, some with high thresholds, some with low, some with virtually no thresholds, it seems, given those conflicting decisions, it's become increasingly important for governments to set out very clearly what it means. And there is, in fact, an attempt to do that in the context of this agreement. So I'm going to look at what that attempt looks like. It's found in Article X.9, essentially meaning the chapter that the investment chapter will be is not yet determined. So it's in here as X, which may be translating to 10 or may not at the end of the day. The treatment of investors and of covered investments. And here we have the opening paragraph, each party shall accord in its territory to covered investments and to investors with respect to their covered investments fair and equitable treatment and full protection and security in accordance with paragraphs 2. And the key part here is the language in accordance with paragraphs 2 to 7. In fact, those numbers have changed their numbers from the previous draft and they weren't fixed up properly when this latest text was done. So that's not a very important issue, just for your information. So the key issue here is in accordance with. And what that does is make the text much more specific than it has previously been. It sets out a precise list of issues. And if we turn to that list in paragraph two, you see the language where a measure or a series of measures constitutes. And then you have five different specific types of government conduct that would breach the measure. So a denial of justice. And here I've highlighted fundamental breach. A fundamental breach sets a threshold, a very high threshold for a breach of due process. It's not just a paperwork breach. It's not an insignificant breach. It's not a breach that has no effective impact on anything, but a fundamental breach that would have to have a significant impact on the judicial and administrative proceedings here that are referred to, or a fundamental breach of due process. Manifest arbitrariness, again, a high threshold of government misconduct. Targeted discrimination on manifestly wrongful grounds. So again, high thresholds of specific types of conduct by the government. Abusive treatment of investors, such as coercion, duress, and harassment. So that's the list as it stands now. And then there is a reference in the following paragraph, H, to a process by which the parties can add other breaches of fair and equitable treatment. And that part doesn't trouble me so much because it has to be added by agreement. So there isn't a way for the arbitrators to unilaterally expand the list here. This is a finite list with fairly high thresholds and fairly specific types of issues. So in terms of comparing this to the previous approaches to fair and equitable treatment, this is actually quite an advancement in terms of the drafting and gives governments greater security in terms of understanding what this might mean in the event of a dispute. In the previous text that was released last November, you see the bracketed paragraph three in the PowerPoint. And this was an extremely troubling paragraph. And it reads, in addition to paragraph two, a breach of fair and equitable treatment may also arise from any other treatment of covered investors, investments or investors, which is contrary to the fair and equitable treatment obligation recognized in the general practices of states accepted as law. So they had both the list and this open-ended catch-all provision. And this open-ended catch-all is now deleted. And that is a significant improvement in the text. And we've been told that change was brought about because of the participation of civil society groups in the consultations and other processes with the commission. So there was an impact from previous inputs, and that impact has led to a very important improvement in the text from the perspective of state rights. And you see in what is now paragraph three, the previous paragraph four, the parties shall regularly or upon request of a party review the content of the obligation to provide fair and equitable treatment. And in fact, that can now go up and down. It could be lead to recommendations to add, or it could lead to recommendations to delete. Where the remaining issue in terms of the fair and equitable treatment obligation comes in is on the next page in the old paragraph five, now paragraph four, the issue of legitimate expectations. Legitimate expectations has been a doctrine that arbitrators have applied to interpreting fair and equitable treatment. And it essentially says in general terms, if the government did or said anything that creates an expectation of governmental conduct toward an investor over the life of the investment, they should be held to that statement, whatever it was. And here we see the specific language. And the language that is most concerning is made a specific representation. When applying the above fair and equitable treatment obligation, a tribunal may take into account whether a party made a specific representation to an investor that created a legitimate expectation upon which the investor relied in deciding to make or maintain the covered investment, but that the party subsequently frustrated. So it opens the door to interpreting any of the previous ones as a breach of legitimate expectations as well. And the big issue to me is, what does a specific representation mean? And I'll compare it in the next discussion or the next slide to the language in the draft, what's called an umbrella clause. Is a specific representation a statement made by a minister in parliament, a statement made at a press conference? Is it any level individual who makes a particular statement to an investor that the state or province or whatever level of government is trying to attract? There is no limitation as to what it means, and it's certainly not left as a legally binding statement that's been made. So it's quite open. And in terms of legitimate, who defines what legitimate is? For example, if a government official, a minister or any other level official, I see there's a question, will we have access to Howie's slides afterwards? I believe the answer to that will be yes, and that will certainly be arranged. Who decides what a legitimate expectation is, and where does that end? If a minister says, don't worry, the law won't change for 20 years, I promise you, does that create a legitimate expectation that there'll be a regulatory standstill in relation to that investment from all levels of government? And that's not an absurd interpretation or an absurd issue to raise, because that type of issue has actually been dealt with, and fair and equitable treatment clauses have often been interpreted by arbitral tribunals as a regulatory standstill provision. So what legitimate means is really important here, as well as what specific representation means. If you look at the next issue, the so-called umbrella clause, an umbrella clause is generally understood to mean a provision in a treaty that says any other obligation the government has entered into vis-a-vis an investor becomes an obligation under the treaty also to be respected. So it incorporates private obligations as treaty obligations and therefore makes them subject to dispute settlement under the treaty as well. So it has quite a broad impact. And here we have the text of what is proposed now by the EU. Each party shall observe. And the old text, the previous one, was any specific written obligation. So a fairly high threshold there, both specific and written, and an obligation to any written comments. Specific is gone and obligation is changed to commitment. What are the meaning? What's the meaning of that? What does that lead one to? Clearly, anybody is going to have access to these materials as a drafting record. And in the event of a dispute, it's guaranteed that these issues will be raised in the tribunal. So what is the significance of this change, and what is it intended to expand coverage to by deleting specific and changing obligation to commitment? And it expressly states, entered into at any level of governmental authority and by any entity exercising such authority in its territory. Again, very broad and open and covering national, subnational, and municipal levels of governments. So that can be an extremely broad provision if it's accepted. And right now it is still under negotiation. And it's important to understand that that's going to be looked at as in addition to the idea of legitimate expectations under Article a 9.5 on fair and equitable treatment. So it's going to have a different interpretation, and that's something that spills back both ways. If here they talk about written commitment, and in the FET provision they talk about specific representation, what does that difference mean? And that difference will be argued about quite vociferously in the context of any dispute. So specific representation, probably broader than written commitment, but we don't really know what the scope of it is. And a little bit better news, the provision on expropriation, and the provision here is very similar to other provisions and in international investment treaties. There's a general framework. Governments are allowed to expropriate. We need to be clear on that. Governments are allowed to expropriate as long as it's done in accordance with law and due process, and there's a procedure to review the quantum of compensation offered by the government, and the government does in fact pay the compensation. The real issue has always been, how does that apply to regulatory measures, environmental protection, human health protection, anti-tobacco legislation, whatever the case might be. And here we have the key provision there in the Annex 11.1 to the text and paragraph 3 of Annex 11.1. And it's for greater certainty, except in the rare circumstance where the impact of the measure or series of measures is so severe in light of its purpose that it appears manifestly excessive, non-discriminatory measures by a party that are designed and applied to protect legitimate public welfare measures, such as health, safety, and the environment, do not constitute indirect expropriations. Out of the range of variations on the theme that we've seen over the last almost 10 years now of this type of drafting, this probably falls at the pretty secure end in terms of government acts. It really requires a breach of a good faith at a fairly high level, and it is not what the Europeans originally sought, which is a proportionality test. A proportionality test would balance the impacts on one investor versus another, or on foreign investors as a group versus domestic investors, and so on and so forth, and balance the public good against the specific harm to the investors. This is not a balancing test. It's a test of whether the measure is so far in excess of its purpose that it appears to be manifestly excessive, disproportionate to the means it tries to serve that it can't legitimately have been done just for that reason. So I think that language doesn't worry me a great deal. I think that's fairly secure now. The biggest concern for me in the drafting now is the most favored nation provision. And here we have a most favored nation provision is essentially a rule that says foreign investors, a government has to treat the foreign investors of country A the same way it treats foreign investors from country B, C, D, and E. And that has generally been interpreted to allow tribunals to read in the provisions of other investment treaties to assess what level of treatment investors from a third country get. And the language here in the text is fairly specific in the first part, and then more obtuse in the second part. And I'll deal with the second part on the next slide. So for greater certainty, the treatment referred to in paragraph 1 and 2, which sets out the rules on MFN, does not include investor state dispute settlement procedures provided for in other international investment treaties or other trade agreements. Now, if we stop there for a moment and ask, what does that mean? Essentially, it assumes that all of the MFN rules, or all of the rules from other treaties, would be covered by the MFN provision, And that is why they chose to exclude the investor state dispute settlement process from that coverage. So the starting point is the MFN rule covers other treaties, the obligations in other treaties, and the exclusion here is just for the investor state dispute settlement process, meaning all the other substantive rules are in, and therefore can be used by reference by investors if there's a dispute under this treaty. The significant impact of that is it essentially undoes all of the effort to redraft old formulations by including old text through the back door of the MFN provision. So if we go back to the FET provision, which is now very carefully drafted, very specifically worded, has a finite list with very high thresholds, and then go to other older treaties, which just say fair and equitable treatment without any thresholds, any definition, the older open-ended provisions that have led to all of the conflicting decisions we've seen so far, those can all be read back in because this MFN provision specifically allows that to be done. And so it undoes the good drafting on FET, it undoes the drafting on expropriation and so on. And that, of course, should be of significant concern because on the one hand, the governments are all saying we've fixed up the old text, the inconclusive text, the open-ended, we've taken care of those risks that were created, and then through the back door, they simply undo all of that work and allow investors to go back to the old treaties and use them as if the new drafting simply hadn't been done. The European Commission has stated that it wanted to exclude all the applications of older treaties, including the substantive applications, and I believe that's what the bracketed language is intended to try and do. Paragraphs 1 and 2, the rules, shall only apply with respect to treatment accorded by a party through the adoption or maintenance of measures, including the application of such measures. And I think the drafters are assuming that reference to measures excludes other treaty obligations. But given the clear implication of the drafting of the previous paragraph we looked at, and given the definition of measure in the actual text of the agreement, my own view is that it simply doesn't do that. If that's what it intends to do, it doesn't achieve that end. I think it would have to be very clear to overcome the express exclusion of dispute settlement and the resulting implied inclusion of other substantive provisions for that to work. And that kind of clarity simply isn't there in this kind of language. So if the intent is to exclude other substantive provisions from other treaties, I don't believe this accomplishes it. And I have yet to see or hear anything from any other lawyers who work in this field to argue that it does effectively cover it. So the impact here is huge. It undoes all the good work done in the drafting of other provisions and allows older provisions to be brought back into any disputes. I'm going to largely skip over the issue of exceptions to national treatment in view of the time. The real issue here is that the text goes from a grandfathering provision to one that requires a specific listing of all existing measures that are incompatible with the inconsistent with the text. So the provincial territorial governments will all have to specifically list any measures they want excluded. There won't be a grandfathering, which the government has effectively done really since NAFTA for provincial governments. That will disappear, so they will have to have very specific lists. Anything not on the list will be fully covered by the agreement, including existing measures. So that's a change that should have, that requires all of the subnational governments to be extremely careful in preparing their lists in a very effective way. There's a reference to an Article 20 type exception. Those of you who work in the trade law area will know Article 20 of the GATT is the general exception for trade measures from exception for environmental measures from the national treatment obligations in the GATT, the trade law. The previous text had an adaptation of Article 20 to investment issues. That adaptation has apparently been removed now, and a general reference is being made to Article 20 of the GATT being applied. Article 20 of the GATT is formulated for trade issues, not investment issues, but that's what they seem to have done in this most recent draft. It's completely off point in terms of for investment regulation purposes. Regulating investments is a very, very different issue than regulating trade. I simply don't see how the inclusion of Article 20 of the GATT will have any bearing on any significant issues as the treaty moves forward, if it does, as it moves forward and goes into any disputes over environmental measures. I just don't see how a reference to Article 20 of the GATT will impact anything from a governmental perspective. And it may actually weaken some arguments because of the inclusion of an exception, even though that exception has no obvious way for it to be applied effectively. On the market access issues, there's a number of provisions that are, and this is important, not going to be covered by the dispute settlement process. So that's a good thing. What concerns me primarily is how this will be applied to investors from other countries, including, for example, investors from China, whether the Chinese agreement would, through the MFN provision on market access in that agreement, cover the same issues here and extend the same limitations on government demands in terms of foreign capital, including maximum percentages or maximum limits on the size of the investment. How would that apply back through the China agreement? There is language in the China agreement that says the MFN provision doesn't extend to a free trade area agreement, present or future. But whether this technically falls as a free trade area or not might be an issue that requires some consideration. So this is very sweeping. It's going to set a number of limitations on what can be done, for example, in the Foreign Investment Review Act and in other contexts, natural resources or elsewhere, in terms of Canada moving at some point in the future to establish limitations on maximum ownership levels or maximum sizes of investments in different sectors. Quick issue on this in terms is the issue of performance requirements. Those are requirements that governments can impose on foreign investors for things like minimum levels of domestic purchasing of goods and services into their production chain. That is an example that is used very often in relation to foreign investment. It's used in relation to investments in the territories now in mining, and especially in the mining sector. There's a number of situations in which investors are subject to requirements to ensure a given level of percentage of purchase of local goods and services from the territories and from Aboriginal peoples. Those kinds of tools and instruments would actually be made inconsistent with this treaty. There are previous treaties that have done this, but this one is going to actually have broader application because a lot of the companies are European owned. So this could be a significant issue in making government requirements for performance requirements actually inconsistent with the treaty. So that's the quick review of the do less harm, do no harm. In terms of do good, I have three issues I wanted to address: the clarity on the rights of states to regulate, obligations of investors, and responsibility and liabilities of investors. In terms of the right to regulate, that text actually isn't in the investment chapter. There is a provision in the preamble to the whole agreement, at least according to the technical summary of final negotiated outcomes that the government put out last November. And there it includes the language that a party's right to regulate, or reaffirming the party's right to regulate in a manner consistent with the agreement. That's language that derives from Article 1114 of NAFTA, and all three NAFTA governments have found that in terms of protecting the government's right to regulate, that language actually does nothing. It simply says you can do whatever you want as long as it's not inconsistent with the agreement. It does not allow any regulation to take place in a manner that is inconsistent with the agreement in any area of regulatory action. So this actually, far from affirming a right to regulate, this actually affirms the primacy of the treaty over the right to regulate of governments. On the issue of obligations of investors and responsibility or liability of investors for their the acts of their investments that are abroad or covered by the agreement, there's no provisions included in the substantive text of the investment chapter. The intent, as I understand it, not all of these parts of the text are available. There'll be either a sustainable development and or labor and environment chapters, but if one looks at the scope of those types of chapters and other EU and Canadian agreements, it's clear they have no legal impact on the investment chapters per se. They create no obligations per se on investors, and the generalized obligations or expressions of rights of states don't do anything to alter the balance of rights and obligations, broadly speaking, between investors and governments. The issue of the obligation not to lower standards in order to attract investment, especially environmental and labor standards, will be in that extra chapter or set of chapters, but of course, if one follows the other models used, will be removed completely from all of these dispute settlement mechanisms and made subject to discussion only and not to any form of dispute settlement. So it's raised to the level of obligation, whereas under NAFTA, it was a should not, an aspirational type of provision. Here it will be an obligation. Government shall not lower their standards, but it won't be subject to any form of dispute settlement. In terms of the obligations of investors specifically, I noted there's nothing in the substantive provisions. There is one related provision in the dispute settlement, ISDS, Investor State Dispute Settlement Text, Article X17, Paragraph 3, which says, for greater certainty, an investor may not submit a claim to arbitration under this section where the investment has been made through fraudulent misrepresentation, concealment, corruption, or conduct amounting to an abusive process. What that shows is that you actually can include certain types of obligations on the investors. and a breach of those obligations can be enforced in one, at least through one mechanism, and that's withdrawing the rights to investor state dispute settlement. So that's what they've done here. In terms of this being absolutely new, though, while it's done here in a very express way, arbitrators have already read this provision into other general rules that define the investor or an investment as an investment that has been made in accordance with the applicable law. So if an investment had been made by fraud or corruption, that wouldn't be in accordance with applicable law, and tribunals have already denied access to investor state arbitration on that basis. In fact, the first time they did that was in 2004. So there's nothing new here. It's expressly being written in, but it's not a new feature in the sense that this has been practice law now for 10 years. Very briefly on investor state dispute settlement, there's been some improvements. There's a roster for appointments to arbitrations, but this is only for limited use when the arbitrators are not appointed by the usual process, which is the government appointing one, the investor appointing one, and both parties agreeing on the third arbitrator. So only in the event that the regular process isn't followed for some reason does the roster apply? And that makes it a fairly limited utility. There are clearer and stronger rules on conflict of interest through the incorporation of the International Bar Association rules on that. So I think that's a welcome addition. There are limits on some of the costs, in particular arbitrators' daily rates, which is useful, but not determinative of anything. There is the inclusion of a default rule that the loser pays the cost of arbitration, which includes the legal fees of the other party that wins. And I think that may be a useful deterrent to some lawsuit, to some arbitrations. It will deter more frivolous, marginal claims to some extent, but we don't know the full extent to which that will act as a deterrent to marginal claims. And there's the express inclusion of transparency rules, which is new for the European Union, but not new for Canada. Canada has had those rules for about 10 years now. So some welcome changes, some useful changes, but nothing that amounts really to a game changer in terms of the functioning of the system. In terms of what those game changers might be, that could be an appeals mechanism, which doesn't exist, and it could be changes in the standard of review of initial decisions that really insulate the decisions from any effective review of the decision unless the decision is reached through real fraud or corruption or really egregious errors of procedure by the tribunal. So it's very hard to review the substantive comment now because of the thresholds of review, and those thresholds are not changed here. So in conclusion on investor state, very quickly, there's some improvements, but in my view, not enough to impact the overall view of the agreement as it stands now. Final conclusions then, words matter. A declaration of intent that is not matched by the words does not achieve the desired results, and that's where we are in terms of some of the issues related to the right to regulate, related to the scope of the MFN provision, and potentially related to the scope of the FET provision. So two very important provisions in terms of the scope of investor protections. Some progress on do less harm, but essentially wiped out by the MFN provision as it stands now. On the do good side, limited progress on corruption and fraud and related issues. But as I noted, this is already in other agreements, so it's not really groundbreaking. It's useful in the way it's expressed, but it's not new law. And on the investor state dispute process, limited progress, but it's clear that only the negotiations with the US, between the US and the EU, will lead to anything really new if those negotiations do carry on in this area. So that's it for the presentation. I apologize for taking so long. Scott? Can't hear you, Scott. Can't hear you. Are you on mute?
Can you hear me now?
Yes.
Perfect. Okay. Sorry about that. Thanks for all that. We're going to go to a Q&A. We have about 15 minutes left if there's things people would like clarified. A couple of options for people who want to ask any questions of Howard. The first is to just use the chat window at the bottom to type a question if it's an easy question, and I can just sort of triage them and put them to Howard. So that's the easiest way. If you do have a microphone available, you can also just up in the top left-hand corner, there's a little symbol of a guy with a hand raised. And if you press on that, I can sort of turn on your microphone, and then you can ask a question verbally of Howard as well. So if you do have any questions, feel free to use one of those two mechanisms.
And it's not just questions, any comments are welcome as well, please.
Just give people, I see some people sort of typing, so we'll give folks a second. So Mike has asked, any thoughts on proposed exemptions to ISDS reported in the media? I assume you're referring to the IP stuff that's been lately. Howard, do you have any thoughts on that?
I haven't heard those reports, so I'm not sure what he's referring to. I know that the okay, he's saying yes, the IP issues. The IP issues are going to be important in terms of in terms of two issues. What is the substantive law that has to be applied? And the Eli Lilly case is a situation where the courts interpreted the law in a way that the government either didn't expect or the company didn't expect. And they're actually saying that's a breach of the standard in the treaty. The problem is in the IP area, nobody knows what IP law is. IP law is changed by the courts every week in Europe and in Canada. Nuances are added, nuances are taken away, issues are addressed in different ways. The one thing that we know about IP law is it is constantly in a state of flux. So, how you define and fix a standard in an international treaty, I'm not really sure. So, that's one issue. The second is the high risk to government and what we've seen in the Eli Lilly case. And we see the same thing in the two tobacco cases against Australia and Uruguay. Which are also both intellectual property related cases. In those instances, not patent issues, but copyright issues, the packaging, copyrights and trademarks, is a wide range of government issues can ultimately be drawn in, such as tobacco legislation. And it gives a, because of the value of some of these issues, especially in the patent area, a really unknown risk level in terms of the level of awards if changes are brought about either by the governments or the courts. So I think it's a real high risk area. Whether they'll be excluded or not, I have my doubts. But anything is still open, and I know everybody, you know, the Europeans wanted to conclude this negotiation. Whether they're still going to do that now, given the fact that the US negotiations are ongoing, I'm not sure. But I would be surprised, but it's no more than a guess if IP issues were fully excluded.
Thanks, Howard. Any other questions from folks, either verbally, if you trust the technology, or in the chat window? I guess what people are thinking, Howard, I would just have a question, which is just how easy would it be for negotiators to fix the MFN concerns that you have?
Extremely. It's extremely easy to do. The Canadian model text from 2004 did it. The Canadian model text in 2004, which was applied up until 2011 or 12, had a provision that said no, the MFN provision does not apply to any treaties concluded before the entry into force of this agreement. So all of the previous agreements were simply excluded that way, substance, process, everything. They just weren't applicable. End of story. That's all it takes. It's not an issue of difficulty in drafting. It's an issue that the Canadian government, for sure, and I don't know the extent to which this is there in Europe or not, the Canadian government wants to have those additional provisions in to give higher levels of protection to Canadian investors abroad, whether it's in Europe or elsewhere. Many people see this agreement as a template for future agreements with other de with developing countries. So there's an issue there of not wanting to exclude those older treaties with other governments. And the Canadian that's a policy decision of the government to include older levels of provision in the scope, older levels in the scope of of the treaty to have higher levels of protection for investors, and they're ready to take whatever risks that means for governments in Canada.
Okay. So John has a question. John, I'm going to try go to you, and you should now be able to speak if your microphone's on.
You also have to push share microphone.
Yeah, up at the top, there's a microphone icon that you should now be able to press, and it should be green. It could be a problem with your mic.
It's not just that, there's a second one, a second drop-down menu. I think that you have to also push share.
Yeah, anyway. We can hear you. You're quite faint, John, but we can hear you, so go ahead.
Okay. Well, I can write it in too, but can you hear me now?
John, maybe type it in if that's okay.
Yep, I'll do that.
Okay. While you're doing that, Blair has also asked, with regard to MFN, to what extent will NAFTA decisions and rules apply to EU and vice versa?
It's not so much that the NAFTA decisions and rules will apply to the EU. That investors from the EU will have the capacity, because of the current drafting of the MFN provision, to ask for the rules in NAFTA that are more favorable towards them compared to the CETA text to be applied, so that the higher level of investor right is something that they can, in a sense, demand because of the MFN provision. So it's a backdoor way to increase the level of investor rights in this case from what would otherwise be drafted in the treaty, and apply to the government, higher standards of obligation or stricter obligations as regards those investors. And it won't just be a question with respect to the NAFTA, it'll be a question with respect to any treaty the government of Canada has concluded, any other investment treaty the government has concluded, going back before NAFTA and between NAFTA and today. So that includes some with older provisions that are more openly stated than even the NAFTA. I hope that answers the question, Blair.
Okay, I see that Dominique is typing a question, and John, I don't know if you were able to get to yours. Okay, Blair says that you covered it. Dominique asks, does that mean that EU could ask for the obligation to export the same proportion of oil year after year as in NAFTA Chapter 6?
That's a good question. Chapter 6 isn't included in the investor rights provision, and Chapter 6 includes two specific issues. One, it protected the Mexican market, Mexican energy market, from foreign investment. So excluded the energy sector in Mexico from foreign investment obligations from Canadian or U.S. Oil, gas, and other energy companies. So it carved out that space for Mexico, and then it imposed the obligation on Canada. If Canada is faced with an energy crisis and therefore reduces its level of exports, the level of reduction had to be pegged to the same reduction of use in Canada based on the level of exports to the US in previous years, in the three previous years. So you took the three previous years of exports to the US as a baseline, and we could only reduce exports to the US to the same degree that there was a reduction of use of oil in Canada from that three-year past record. My guess is unless there's an exclusion from that in the general agreement, that there is a significant risk that obligation under Chapter 6 would indeed apply to Europe in the future. So if there are significant levels of exports of oil and gas to Europe that take place, and we see obviously now with the geopolitical situation in Russia and the Ukraine and everywhere else, shifts in oil production, oil consumption patterns are something Europe is trying to do, or where sourcing their energy anyway is what they're trying to do. So the idea of additional exports of oil from Canada to Europe would be highly likely. That could be a factor, but I haven't looked at that specifically, but that's a good issue to raise.
Okay, thanks for that. We're coming up on an hour now, so I see John is typing, so I'll just let him finish and maybe we'll take that as the last question. And then we'll sign off. And just as John is doing that, I think he's doing that. There it is. I'll just say that I'll definitely circulate the recording we've made of the webinar, as well as Howard's PowerPoint slides, assuming that's all right with him. So John asks, can international investor access ISDS even though not discriminated against relative to domestic investors? For example, a country implements a policy that will increase costs of both domestic and international investors, such as requiring a shift to more sustainable energy sources. Can the foreign investors use ISDS to claim compensation for the additional costs?
Yes. There's two types of obligations in the investor obligations. One is comparative, the comparison of treatment between the foreign investor and domestic investors. That's one type, the national treatment MFN provisions. The second type is fair and equitable treatment and expropriation, which would be particularly relevant here. And those are not comparative. Those are purely the rights of the foreign investor. So if, for example, there's a foreign investment producing electricity, a big electricity plant, and they were required to shut down, use the Ontario example. Recently, Ontario shut down its last two coal-fired facilities. If those were in foreign investor hands, it would be entirely possible and probable that the foreign investor would argue that the shutting down of that plant because of its pollution and requiring it to shift to an alternative fuel source to generate the electricity was an expropriation, irrespective of the fact that Canadian plants also had to follow that regulation.
Thanks for that, Howard. So we're up on an hour, so I'll just close by thanking on behalf of everybody, Howard, for your time and for your expertise on these issues, and thanks to everyone for finding the time to join in on the webinar. And as I say, I'll circulate to everybody the recording of Howard's presentation and the discussion as well. So thanks for finding the time, everyone, and thanks especially to you, Howard.
If there's any questions when you get the text or you know other questions that come up, please feel free either to contact me directly or through Scott. Thanks everyone. Great. For joining. Hope that was useful.
Thanks very much. So thanks everyone. Take care.